Steal my heart and hold my tongue. I feel my time has come. Let me in, unlock the door. I never felt this way before. The wheels just keep on turning. The drummer begins to drum. I don't know which way I'm going. I don't know which way I've come. Hold my head inside your hands. I need someone who understands. I need someone, someone who hears. For you I've waited all these years. For you I'd wait till kingdom come, until my day is done, and say you'll come.
Listen to Travis and Heather join together as husband and wife, but we're also here among friends and family, and God has blessed us with an incredible day, which only means good things are going to happen, Heather. That's great. And It's just great to be here. It's great to see Heather. I've known Heather for many, many years. I worked with her when she was a teenager and had a lot of time talking with Heather over the years about her life. And it looks like, Travis, you're the answer to her prayer, and that's awesome. And so on behalf of them, thank you guys for being here today. The thing that we need to remember is that not only are we all here as friends and as family, but God is also present here. And really, this is all about Him. Now, I know it's about the bride, too, but really, this ceremony is just symbolic of Christ's love for us. And He calls the church the bride of Christ. And Jesus thinks of us as His bride and bridegrooms, and that is what this wedding is all about. It glorifies Jesus Christ. Everything that we're going to talk about, the prayers, all the vows that we do today are all about what Jesus Christ means to us and what He did for us in living a perfect life and being crucified and then being resurrected, as we celebrated just a few days ago. So this is an exciting time. God is here with us. And so I guess my first question is who gives this woman's hand in marriage?
Her proud father.
Right. Travis and Heather, it's been a road for you guys. And I know a little bit about the story. I don't know all the details. I've known Heather a lot longer than I've known you, Travis. But what's so cool about today is this is just the beginning of a journey. And some of us think it's kind of the end of the journey, but it's not. I mean, God has been involved in your lives from the moment you were conceived, from the moment you were in your mother's womb. The Bible tells us that He knows us and that He knitted us together. And He gave each of us a purpose. And so we're just living out that purpose. God saw all of this years ago. And so He is here today, as I said earlier. He is in celebrating. And what a road it's been and what a journey it's been. And so today is the beginning of a different kind of journey in your life. You know, being a husband and being a wife is far different from being a boyfriend and a girlfriend or just buddies, or you guys just started out kind of as, you know, distant friends, and God has brought you together, and it's been incredible to hear and see how you got to this point today, and it's just awesome. So this ceremony is a celebration of His love and His plan for your lives, and you know, God talks a lot about marriage in the Scripture, and I don't want to preach a message. That's not what I'm doing for weddings because it's too long. But, you know, I think it's always important to remember that this was God's idea. You know, our culture today doesn't see it that way. But those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ, we know that this has always been His plan for humanity since the beginning of time, since He created Adam, the man. And then He watched Adam, the Bible tells us, working and naming these animals and, you know, seeing the animals come together and having babies. And Adam was going, well, where's mine, God? I mean, everybody's God's mine. Who's mine? And the Bible says that God saw that man needed a helpmate. Now, it's important to understand the word helpmate. What that means is when God created the woman, He created somebody who was equal to the man. Heather, you're not less than equal. You're not less than inferior. In fact, we all know you're the smartest person here. Travis, as soon as you figure that out, your life will be so much easier. So, but God saw that the man needed a helpmate. And so He created, the Bible says, a woman out of the man. And then presented the woman to Adam. And the Bible says in Genesis 2, let me just read a couple of those passages because that's what it's all about. Genesis 2. The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found because the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, He took one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib He had taken out of the man. He brought her to the man, and the man said, this is now after he went, wow. Then he said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And the Bible says, for this reason, a man, that's you, a man will leave his father and mother, and that means permanently, leave your father and your mother, and be united to his wife, and if you leave your father and your mother too, to be united as his wife, and they will become one flesh. Now, marriage begins at the point when the one flesh relationship begins. Now, when we talk about a one flesh relationship, I'm talking about not only a physical relationship, but one flesh in the Bible means that you literally are knitted together as one person spiritually and emotionally, physically, you are one. And so when God came up with this covenant, he knew what he was doing, and he knew that man couldn't make it alone. He knew that woman couldn't make it alone, so he brought the two together to make them one flesh. And so that's what we're here to celebrate, is this plan, this design of what God has done with each of us. The Bible says a lot about marriage, how we're supposed to do this. And again, you know, the culture doesn't really dig this stuff. And I just want to say, this is not my stuff, this is out of the Bible, okay? So I'm not making it up, but the Bible talks about submission in marriage. And the Bible says that marriage will not work until the man and the woman understand what that means. Now, again, when I say that word, I can just feel some women over here. You know, they're just starting to shake and get a little, you don't know my husband. I said, no, I don't. I don't know. But that's not the way it works. And really what the word submission means, and I think it's important because, again, it gets such a bad rap in our culture. And it's so important for marriage to work. And the reason why most marriages work or don't work is because people don't understand what God's really talking about here. But the word, the definition, the Greek definition of the word means a voluntary attitude of giving in. It doesn't mean that you're less than him, Heather. It doesn't mean that Travis is smarter than you and that he holds a big stick and you don't. It just means that it's a voluntary attitude of giving in, cooperating, assuming responsibility, and carrying a burden with him. That's what submission means. It's not you're less than him. And all it is it means that at the cross, the Bible says we're all equal. You before God are equal. Man is equal to woman. It's just he gives us a different job description when it comes to marriage.
And you know, God's a God of order. He's not a God of chaos. He has a plan for us. He has a reason why he does what he does. He tells us why he does what he does and why it's important to follow those guidelines, because it's how it works. I mean, after all, he did create it, and he does understand it better than anybody. And he made us and created us, and he knows how we work. And so God said
that you are, Heather, to submit to your husband. Now, some of you may be asking, why would Heather do a dumb thing like that? Why would she submit to this guy? Now, I don't know Travis as well as some of you do, but some of you are going, that is never going to work. I'm going to use tongue right now. And maybe not. I don't know. But here's what the Bible says about the whole thing. Let me read Ephesians chapter 5. Now, Ephesians is an interesting letter that Paul wrote, because Paul is writing this letter to Christians in a church, and he's telling them how they can be followers of Jesus. So it's really written to Christians, and it's basically how do we do things to make things right. And so he writes this whole section on marriage, because it's a huge thing. I mean, that's a huge part of our lives for all of us. And the Bible says that in chapter 5, we're to be imitators of God. So therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. So we're to imitate him. And that's important to understand, that your life is all about following Jesus Christ. Even before you worry about following each other, you need to be following after Jesus, because the more you follow after Jesus, the closer you guys will get to each other. That's the whole secret to it. It's not looking at it. Travis, Heather's never going to live up to your ideals of being the perfect wife. And neither one of you are ever going to be perfect. You're going to make mistakes, and you're going to make each other mad. That's okay, because it's not that you're building your marriage on each other. You're building your marriage on Jesus. And that's what makes it so cool, is that when you do mess up, you just continue to follow after Jesus. You love each other. You forgive one another. As he said, you become imitators of God. And that's huge when you're talking about marriage. And then he says this. Here's the real controversial stuff. Verse 21 says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now remember, Jesus had submitted himself to become a human being. The worst submission of all. I mean, to be God and to become a human, that's as bad as anything could ever happen to him. But he did it willingly and lovingly so that we could have a personal relationship with him through his death, with his Father through him. And so he says then, Paul writes, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, the job description. This is the organization of marriage. The husband is to be the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, why God chose the man, I have no idea. It's not a smart decision in my opinion. I mean, really, the woman should be running this thing. But God, in his infinite wisdom, ask us, Travis, to lead the family. Now, we also know it's smart that if we're going to lead the family, the rest of this chapter talks about how do we gain our wife's submissive attitude. Because, I mean, really, she's going to voluntarily give it up, but why should she? I mean, what do you have to offer? I mean, she's got a lot more to offer than you do. I just hate to tell you. But you know, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says this. Husbands, now this is how she will submit to you, and why she will submit to you, and why this thing will work, because all of this is about you. See, God knew we need a lot of help here. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. So, you know, if you love her as Christ loved the church, then she's going to have no problem in following your leadership. I mean, who wouldn't want that deal? I mean, Heather, if he's going to love you like that, if he's going to willingly give his life for you, if he's going to take everything, your hopes and your desires and your dreams into consideration before anything is done in your family, I sign up for that deal all day long. I mean, women, if you're not married, this is who you're looking for. I mean, you know, this is what it means to find a godly husband. It says, also, he says, husbands, you ought to love your wives as your own bodies. Now, you're a good-looking guy. You really are. And I'm sure you look at yourself and go, wow, look at me. I am cool. But it's that attitude. The Bible says that we ought to love her. And when you look at yourself in the mirror and go, wow, look at me, that's how you should treat her. Every time you see Heather, you look at her and go, wow, she is incredible. She is a work of art. You put her on a pedestal, and you do that, she's going to have no problem submitting to your leadership and your family. It also says that, after all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it just as Christ does for the church. We are members of his body. So for that reason, the Bible says, a man will leave his father and mother. As Genesis said, Paul is just repeating exactly what the Old Testament says. But he will be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery. We really don't know how all of this works. I mean, it is a profound mystery. We don't understand it all fully until we stand before the Father. Will we really understand his love and why he did it this way, why he put you two together of all the billions of people that could have been chosen to be your spouses? He picked you two to be together. That's a profound mystery. We don't know why that is. But he says, but I'm not talking so much about marriage, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife, that's you, as he loves himself, and the wife must respect the husband. Now, that whole word respect is probably more, is a better description than submission. Because, you know, Travis, if you do those things the Bible teaches, if you love her as Christ loved the church, if you love her as much as you love your own body, if you take her needs and wants and desires into all the things that are happening in your family, I mean, ultimately, you make the decisions. But let me just tell you again, it's smart to go with her 99% of the time. God has given women a discernment above men that's unbelievable. Sometimes they're wrong, but not very often. And don't tell them that. You just
It's okay, honey, I got you. And you just need to make the decision. But ultimately, here's the serious part of this deal, is when you stand before God, he's not going to go, Heather, how did the marriage go? He's not going to, I mean, he's going to look at you and he's going to go, Travis, did you hold up to the facts that you promised? I was at that wedding. Did you do what you said you would do? And so he holds us accountable. And he holds us responsible. And that's why this is such a huge deal that we stand up here and we say these vows, because it's a promise. It's a promise that's made for as long as we both live, as long as we all live. That vow lasts forever. So that's just huge. So that whole submission thing is way overdone. It's a matter of, if you'll do your job, she is definitely going to sign up for that deal. She will be with you and for you and support you and do everything that needs to be done in the family. But answer these statements with an I will before we continue on. If you don't say I will, we're just going to go to the reception. Okay? So think long and hard. All right. Travis, do you take Heather to be your wedded wife? Do you commit yourself to her happiness, her self-fulfillment as a person, her usefulness in the kingdom of God? Do you promise to love her and comfort her, honor her, and keep her for better or worse, richer or poorer, in sickness and health, so long as you both shall live?
I will.
Heather, do you take Travis to be your wedded husband? Do you commit yourself to his happiness, his self-fulfillment as a person, and his usefulness in the kingdom of God? Do you promise to love him, comfort him, honor him, and keep him for better or worse, richer or poor, in sickness and in health, so long as you both shall live? Right. Now, Travis's sister Micah is going to come and read a couple of scriptures.
1 John 4:16. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love.
Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. Romans 12:9-12. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer.
Got mine on my head.
For high tech.
Yeah. Love is a mighty power, a great and complete love, or complete good. Love alone lightens every burden and makes the rough places smooth. It bears every hardship as though it were nothing and renders all bitterness sweet and acceptable. The love of Jesus is noble and inspires us to great deeds. It moves us always to desire perfection. Love aspires to high things and is held back by nothing base. Love longs to be free, a stranger to every worldly desire, lest its inner vision become dimmed and less worldly self-interest hinder it or ill fortune cast it down. Nothing is sweeter than love, nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing wider, nothing more pleasant, nothing fuller or better in heaven or earth. For love is born of God and can rest only in God above all created things. Love flies, runs, leaps for joy, it is free and unrestrained. Love gives all for all, restrained one who is highest above all things, from whom every good flows and proceeds. Love does not regard the gifts, but turns the giver of all good gifts. Love knows no limit, but ardently transcends all bounds. Love feels no burden, takes no account of toil, attempts things beyond its strength. Love sees nothing as impossible, or feels able to achieve all things. Love, therefore, does great things.
All right, now Cameron and Annalise will sing a song for us.
Pick up my life, lay down my own, and on this altar known as love, you made an orphan child a son. You made an orphan child a son.
course. You brought me home from distant shores, and on this altar void of bread, you made a holy girl, your bride, made a holy girl, your bride. And now I'm standing face to face. Call me friend, no deeper love I've ever known. When your heart became my home, when your heart became my home. And now I'm standing face to face, here with angels and their saints.
Found those guys, they're pretty good. That's $1 million worth of money I spent on guitar lessons. Working right on.
No, that's great, Cameron and Elise. Now it's time to make this official. I'm going to ask you to hold hands and look at each other face to face. Travis, I want you to repeat this vow after me. I, Travis, offer myself completely to you.
Offer myself completely to you.
To be your husband in marriage.
I promise
to love you with all my heart.
To love you with all my heart.
To be true and faithful.
To be true and faithful.
Patient and kind.
Patient and kind.
Unselfish and giving.
Unselfish and giving.
In this love.
In this love.
I promise to stand beside you always.
Stand beside you always.
In times of joy.
In times of joy.
In times of trial.
In times of trial.
And in times of sorrow.
I dedicate our marriage
and our home to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Heather, if you will, gaze deeply into Travis's eyes and repeat after me. I, Heather,
offer myself completely to you
to be your wife in marriage.
I promise to love you
with all my heart, to be true and faithful.
Patient and kind.
Unselfish and giving.
In this love.
I promise.
To stand beside you always.
In times of joy.
In times of trial.
And in times of sorrow.
I dedicate our marriage.
And our home.
To the Lordship of Jesus Christ.
Now we're going to exchange the rings. And, the rings are just simply symbolic. Now, Travis, I ask every husband to be this question, because some of them don't know the answer. If you lose your ring, are you still married?
Absolutely.
Okay. The ring doesn't marry.
No.
The ring, it's not a good idea to lose it, but it's not a good idea to lose yours, but it's symbolic.
And really, when I do these ring ceremonies and talk about the ring, I can't help but look at this thing that cost $90 that I got 34 years ago from my ultimate. I met this skinny girl from West Texas. Loved it. First class I had as a freshman at Tech. 34 years later, we're married. And this ring reminds me of the vow I took to promise to love her. And the same vow that you guys did for each other. So really, the rings are simply a reminder to you
of the vows today reminds you forever this wedding ceremony. And not only that, but what's important about these rings is it tells everybody else, hands off. You know, that you've already found your ultimate person. There's nobody else, so why are you messing around with me? You know, that, and so that ring shows everybody else that you're taken. It reminds you that you're taken. And it's just, and plus it makes you look good. So, you know, it's great to have.
So, we're going to exchange the rings now. And first of all, I'm going to ask St. Travis if you'll take the ring and
place it on Heather's ring finger there on the left hand. That's that one.
Okay. I know you're a doctor. I have medical terms. Okay, and if you would repeat this after me. Heather.
Heather.
With this ring.
I pledge my life.
And love to you.
And love to you.
Father.
Father,
the Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
And if you would take the ring and place it, Travis's left hand. Repeat this hour. Travis,
with this ring,
I pledge my life,
and love to you.
In the name of the Father,
the Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
Let's
pray. Father, I just thank you so much for this beautiful day. Day of celebration, this day of being around our friends and our family and seeing people that we haven't seen for a long time. It's just been an awesome time, but God, we're also thankful for what this all represents, the fact that you loved us, that you have a plan for us, that you have walked beside Travis and Heather from the very beginning to bring them to this point, and you're not going to leave them alone. God, you will continue to be a part of their lives. I'm so thankful for that. We're thankful for your love. We're thankful for the fact that you allowed your son Jesus to die on the cross to be raised again so that if we just believe in him, that we will have eternal life. And God, I'm just so thankful to be a part of this ceremony. And I just pray that as Travis and Heather begin this journey, that you will just walk with them, be with them, lift them up, God. We all here promise to pray for them also, because we want to see them succeed and to do the best that they can do as husband and wife. I pray all of these things in your precious Son's holy name. Amen. All right. Travis and Heather, because you have made these commitments before God and these witnesses, by the authority of God, I pronounce you husband and wife. You are no longer two independent persons, but as we said, you are now one. So what God has joined together, no one can separate. Travis, you may kiss the bride. Everybody. It gives me honor to introduce to you for the very first time,
Dr. and Mrs. Travis and Heather Rose.